What is up, everybody? Happy Wine Wednesday. Welcome on in to NHL Puckline. I'm Lauren Jbara. That's Drew Goldfarb. Drew, how was your weekend? Happy Wednesday.
Yeah, I'm doing good. But wine, it's 9 a.m. out here on the West Coast, but I go for, I guess, a mimosa to start the day. Is that what we're doing here? I left mine in the downstairs in the kitchen.
5 o'clock somewhere, right? 5 o'clock somewhere.
Hey, it works
always
for me.
A lot going on tonight.
That's why you just had some orange juice.
I know, seriously. Just add a little drop, just a little splash. Why not? You know, We're cooking up something good. You want to know who else is cooking up something good? It's the bread man, Artemi Panarin. He's been on absolute fire this season. 24 points in 14 games, 8 goals, 16 assists. He has a point, Drew, in every single game so far this season. He opened to win the Hart at 75-1 odds and has plummeted to 25-1. What's been most impressive about what he's done so far this season?
Well, you mentioned the fact that he has at least 1 point in every single game. It's that consistency. It's absolutely unreal. The Rangers are on fire right now. 9-0-1 in their last 10 games. Panarin has multi-point games in, I think, 8 of those 10. It's just been phenomenal the way that he has played this season. And you see the way that those numbers have dropped. You're still getting 24-1 for a guy that's on pace for 47 goals and 94 assists this season, both of which would just completely shatter career highs for him. So even if that pace slows a bit, or even slows a lot, we could see him at 35 and 70 and topping 100 points. And obviously from the Rangers' perspective, if they keep going 9-0-1 every 10 games from here on out, they'll be thrilled with that. But Panarin still value to take him to win MVP this year.
I know at this point, this is the time to grab him, right? I know he's moved down so much, but before he moves down more, grab him at 24-1 odds. If you got him at 75-1, props and congrats to you, and you're probably a Rangers fan. I'm also not used to seeing Artemi Panarin with a shaved head, so that kind of threw me off for a second. But, you know, it's been a great look for him this season. We got 4 games on the slate tonight, none of those including the Rangers, but we do have a Metro battle. Let's talk about the Flyers-Canes. That game is on 7:30 p.m. on TNT and Max. We have the Kraken taking on the Oilers, new look-ish Oilers at this point with the new head coach. We have the Ducks, second half of a back-to-back in the Mile High City, taking on the Avs. And then we can't finish without the Isles, who are on a 5-game skid right now. Sorry to our producer, Matthew Nicholson, going up against one of the hottest teams in the National Hockey League in the Canucks. That game also on TNT and Max tonight. But let's start it out with the Flyers taking on the Canes. Philadelphia flown down to Raleigh to take on the Canes, and neither team has played since Saturday. So both at this point are going to be very well rested. It's two teams that have been pretty hot. The Flyers, they're 7-7-1. They won their last 2 games. They took advantage in SoCal, beating both the Ducks, quack, quack, and the Kings. But offensively, they're averaging 3.2 goals per game. They have scored 10 total goals in each of their, in their last 2 games combined. And Cam Atkinson has been really, really good. He has 3 points, Drew, in the last 2 games. What's impressed you most about him? I'm really getting the Flyers going this season.
Yeah, I mean, that's been a nice little run. And obviously, we're going to see what he can do against a team like Carolina right now. But 8 goals for the whole year. So he had been pointless in 3 straight, snapped out of it with those couple goals that he's picked up. He had 2 goals in the previous 6 games. So that's been a nice way to kind of turn things around. The Flyers, obviously, a really hot start to the season. So we'll see if they can get back on track here. This is really kind of the crucial kind of points to get is it when you're playing within the division, especially against a team like Carolina, currently in 3rd place in their division. But, you know, you kind of expect them to be more near the top as time goes on if the Rangers, you know, don't go 9-0-1 over every set of 10 games that they play from here on out. Cam Atkinson, though, the 8 goals, 12 points for the season, leading the team in shots. The Flyers have been very just spread out as far as their offense goes. 3 players, exactly 48 shots so far this season. 5 forwards with a double-digit point total so far this year. So that's kind of been the thing for the Flyers. And it's that spreading it out and that consistency that if the Flyers are going to contend for a wild card spot, maybe contend for a 3 spot in the Metro for the postseason this year, they've got to have that consistency and that team effort throughout the whole season and not just a little streaky like we've seen. So a matchup against the Canes is quite the test for this Flyers team.
Something they really need to do, though, is get their power play going. Right now, functioning at a 7.7% rate, they're 0 for 25 in their last 25 times on the man advantage. So they really need to figure that out. But defensively, they're only allowing 3.07 goals per game. Yes, they've been missing Rasmus Ristolainen and Mark Stahl, and they're still decent on the defensive side. They're allowing the third fewest shots on goal in the league to their opponents. And Carter Hart was out with food poisoning the last two games. The team did well, two wins. Now they're back. Now he's back in full health, 913 save percentage on the season. But he's definitely going to be tested tonight against a Canes team that are coming off of a 4-0 win against the Lightning at Amalie Arena. They're 6-2-0 in their last eight, a perfect 4-0 on home ice. They only have three games in a stretch of 8 days, so their legs are feeling good. They're feeling rested, and offensively, they're averaging over 3.25 goals per game. Jesperi Kotkaniemi, say that five times fast, is leading the team with 13 points, tied with Sebastian Aho. But he's really been solidifying that second line and helping their offense move forward.
Yeah, 3 goals, 3 assists in his last 9. He opened the season with 7 points in his first 6. So technically, that's a bit of a slowdown, but it's still been really solid for him. 5 points through the first 26 games last season. So really a much stronger start for him this year than he had a year ago. He did close out last season with 38 points in his last 56 games. So if you basically look over the course of his last 71 games played, he has been a very, very good player for this Carolina Hurricanes team. Is going up against Carter Hart, who is confirmed to be making his return to the Flyers crease tonight. You mentioned the Flyers not giving up a lot of shots. The Canes, even fewer, just 26 shots on goal for their opponents this season. But Kotkaniemi has been really solid, a good contributor for this Canes team. And like I said, even if you go back towards last season, he had that slow start, but he's been very good, even if he's technically slightly slowed down in the last few weeks. I still like what he's been doing for this Canes team so far this season and really throughout the 2023 calendar year.
Yeah, and their special teams have been really good. Their power play functioning at over a 25% rate, so they need to keep that going defensively, allowing just about 3.25 goals per game. No Frederik Andersen, out indefinitely with blood clotting. This could be maybe a decent under game. I don't know. Who knows if you want to get the under sweats in this one, but when you look at a side, how do you lean? Do you lean the Canes? Because they're right now you're laying about $2.50 to take them on the money line.
I mean, honestly, the way that I usually approach things, if I see a -2 to start, I have like no interest in that. So you have to look somewhere else. Yeah, it's not worth the 3 hours you're going to be without your money, even if it comes back to you.
Yeah.
So you've got to look somewhere else on that, whether that's a 60-minute money line, which is usually my favorite way in hockey to try and avoid that kind of thing. Because if you're going to take a puck line, if you're going to take the Canes to cover, the 60-minute money line is going to pay out anyway. And then if you don't get that empty net goal late in the game, you don't have to worry about it. You don't have to sweat it. You just have to worry about not getting to OT, where a puck line's not going to pay out anyway. So for me, that's usually my favorite bet if you're on the Canes side of things. Plus 205 on the Flyers, the way they've played this season. I mean, it's if you kind of think that they've been a little Jekyll and Hyde for the year. If you think that they're going to be more, I always forget which one the good one was of Jekyll and Hyde. And it's 9 a.m., so my brain's not processing which one was the good guy. Yeah, that's tell us in the chat. But anyway, yeah, at better than 2-1 for the Flyers, maybe. But I'm probably going 60-minute money line on the Canes side of things. The under is intriguing.
I do like
this goaltending matchup.
Yeah, and honestly, I need to Google more about Jekyll and Hyde at this point because I just realized I don't know anything about that, but that's okay. We have the Flyers taking on the Carolina Hurricanes tonight. That game is on at 7:30 p.m. You can watch it on TNT and stream it live on Max. Next up, the Kraken. What's Kraken, Drew? Have headed north of the border to take on Edmonton Oilers. They've already seen each other once. The Oilers came out on top. Seattle right now trying to figure it out. They've lost 4 of the last 5 games, most recently in the Mile High City, 5-1 to the Avs. They're bottom 4 in the league right now when it comes to goals scored per game, which is definitely different than what we saw from them last season. Maybe they're playing below their means. Maybe they regressed to what their expectation is, to what their average is. But right now, they're averaging 2.5 goals per game. Oliver Bjorkstrand, one of the team's leading scorers at this point. He has 12 points in 16 games. He is providing that depth scoring from the third line. But they need to see a lot more guys get going to really have that offensive prowess this season.
Yeah, this is the time of year when you're about 15-ish, 16 games into the season where you can start looking at, okay, how many players do you have in double-digit points so far? And for Seattle, it's three, and one of them is Vince Dunn, the defenseman. So Bjorkstrand at 12 points, nicely split, 6 goals, 6 assists so far for the year. But they're not generating a ton of shots on goal, averaging just under 30 shots on goal per game for the season. So if you can increase those numbers, just kind of get pucks to the net. You kind of said it's both of these teams are very similar, as you mentioned, basically trying to find themselves, figure out who they are. Is this Seattle Kraken team the team we saw?
Oh, we lost Drew. That's okay, because he'll be back and better than ever. But defensively, the Kraken on three. Eight in the league, Philip Grubauer, 3-6-0 record. He really hasn't been helping his cause this season with an .891 save percentage. But with the Edmonton Oilers, are they having a revival? They won on Saturday. Sunday, Jay Woodcroft was fired. They pulled off a big win on Monday, 4-1 against the Isles. And Connor McDavid, in that game on Monday, did not just look like a shell of himself. He had a goal. He had an assist. He's feeling really good right now. And I feel like the team needs him to continue producing at the pace that he's used to producing, but they also need other guys. Drew, he's back. He's better than ever. Tell me about Leon Draisaitl this season, because obviously he's leading the way for this Oilers team. Never disappoints, 19 points in 14 games, 1 goal, 3 assists in his last game, but it's the other guys around him that they really need to get going to find that juice this season.
Yeah, I mean, what more could you expect out of a guy like Draisaitl than 19 points through his first 14 games, especially with the way the Oilers have gone? Edmonton ranks fourth in the NHL in expected goals for, first in the NHL in scoring chances for per game. They're just not finishing. And I know that's just kind of an easy way to say, oh, they just need to get more goals, or is it puck luck? If you like that phrase, or if you don't like that phrase, then forget I said anything. But Draisaitl has been really contributing so far. The 46 shots on goal through 14 games would scare me away from taking him for at least four. Seattle only gives up about 29 shots on goal per game this season as a team, 31 shots on goal per game as a team so far this season. But Draisaitl's been the big contributor for this team for the year. I think Edmonton maybe turns things up. We know that their offense is capable, right? So this is a situation, there's too much top-end talent for this team to not start scoring and start converting on goals this season. So Draisaitl's been doing what he's needed to do. McDavid had a good game in his last one. Obviously, he had the injury issue earlier in the year. So we'll see what Edmonton is doing as we enter December, because obviously entering the month of November, they were not in the position they wanted to be in.
Yeah, and we'll see how, you know, this resurgence of a new head coach, maybe that brings them a different vibe to their locker room. Who knows? But they do need to find that depth scoring. Last season, it was their offense that made up for what they lacked on defense. And this year, the Oilers, not much has changed. They're the third worst defensive team. They're allowing 3.71 goals per game. Stuart Skinner, been okay, I guess I should say. Jack Campbell, I mean, he was obviously moved down after signing that big, big deal. So Oilers fans definitely disappointed in that. But Stuart Skinner playing to an .876 save percentage. I will say Edmonton's won 3 straight against Seattle. So it'll be interesting to see how this game plays out. They're heavy favorites in this one, minus 184 at this point. So we'll see what happens in Edmonton. Maybe they'll get it going again, a third straight win. If they do, can this be enough to resurge them for the season? That game is on tonight, 8:30 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN+. Root Sports and Sportsnet. Next up, the Ducks. My quack is so bad. I'm going to work on it. Todd's told me I'm really bad at it too. It's okay. We have a lot of season left to go. But they have quacked all the way from... I know. It sounds like a dying duck.
No improvements, no notes. Just keep doing it that way the whole season long. You're doing fine.
I know. Honestly, I did that too with the Atlanta Hawks. I would always try to do like their caw, caw that Shaq does. And I sounded like a dying bird. I just cannot do bird sounds. That's okay. We're accepting it and we're moving on. But the Ducks have cracked all the way from Nashville, where they played last night, to the Mile High City to take on the Colorado Avalanche. The Ducks 8-2-0 in their last 10. Well, the Avs have had a little drop off. They're 5-5-0 in their last 10, but they're still second in the Central. They started the season off undefeated, and they've lost 5 of their last 10 games. So definitely something to look out for. They've been shut out 3 times in those 10 games as well. Now, for the Ducks, No one expected anything of them this season, and they've been quacking all season long. They're on the second half of a back-to-back, though. They may have some heavy legs in this one. Offensively, they're scoring over 3.1 goals per game. It's a young team that's caught in heat. Let's talk about Mason McTavish. He's in his third season in the league, tied for the team's leading scorer, 16 points in 15 games, really solidifying that second line. Drew, he's been impressive this season.
Yeah, and especially because the young players that we thought would be contributing for Anaheim so far this year just haven't been able to so far in Trevor Zegras. McTavish, an assist last night. He has a point in three straight and 10 of his last 11 games. So he has been really shouldering a bit of the offensive load for the Anaheim Ducks this season. And lately, they overcame a 2-0 deficit in Nashville last night. And you said heavy legs, and that I was watching that game and watching Radko Gudas take a puck to the side of the foot. You want to talk about heavy legs, but I'm sure that he seemed to be fine in the post-game interview there. So that looked like that stung quite a bit. But McTavish has just been really good. 16 points ties him for the team lead with Frank Vetrano. So he's just been very consistent in the last few weeks, last a number of weeks so far for this Anaheim Ducks team. And that's how Anaheim is sitting at that 9-6-0 record.
Yeah, they're definitely been very impressive all season defensively. They're good too, allowing only 2.87 goals per game. A lot of their success too has been because of their goaltending. John Gibson was phenomenal last night. Lucas Dostal getting the start today. He has a 9.10 save percentage on the season, 5-2-0 record. Now on the other side, let's get into the Colorado Avalanche, because they've been a really interesting team. They started out the season red hot. We know the firepower that they bring to the ice on any given night, but it really has been tailing off a little bit lately. Offensively, they're scoring 3.36 goals per game. Yes, Nathan MacKinnon has soared, and I mean flown, over the last five games. You could say coming down a mountain like an avalanche. 9 points in the last five, including 2 3-point games. He has 18 points, Drew, on the season. It's the guys around him that need to get going again, but Nathan MacKinnon definitely been living up to, if not exceeding, expectations.
Yeah, MacKinnon 18 points this season. Mika Rantanen 21 points this season. Kale McCarr 18. There isn't another player on the Avalanche with double-digit points yet through their first 14 games. So they are very top-heavy with who has been contributing offensively with any kind of consistency this season. MacKinnon going into this game, obviously you mentioned the streak he's been on. Last season against the Ducks, 3 games, 3 goals, 3 assists, 16 shots on goals. So any of those bets would be reasonable ones that you could take if you wanted to for MacKinnon for this one. 5 shots on goal is usually a number that might scare me a little bit, just because it's five. That is just a huge number. But if you're going to go with anybody, MacKinnon is one of those few guys in the NHL where taking for at least 5 shots for any particular game is not crazy to do. And going up against a team like Anaheim, we could see what happens there. They do give up about 32 shots on goal per game this season, so that could be a reasonable play to make.
MacKinnon is averaging 4.8 shots on goal per game this season. I look at the last five games, Drew, and the Avs goalies have allowed 23 total goals. They're stopping only 83.6% of chances. At this point, the defense needs to tighten up a little bit to help with the offensive struggles they've been having, albeit not the top three guys, but everyone else. Val Nichushkin is the next closest scorer, like you said, with only 9 points. When I look at this game, I'm like, obviously I want to take the Avs. They're a heavy favorite. You're basically laying $3 to get them on the money line. I know you have a same game parlay with this one. Give it to us. What do you got? Help us make some money.
So again, if I don't like it at -2XX, I certainly don't like a money line at -300. So I'm starting with Colorado on a 60-minute money line. We know that Anaheim just had to travel in overnight. It was a big effort to come back to win 3-2 yesterday in Nashville. Now they're in Denver. Only one of Colorado's first 14 games have gone to OT. It's 3 out of 15 for Anaheim. John Gibson played yesterday, so they are going to their other goaltender, Dostal, who's been very good this season, but I still like the Avs to win. Nathan MacKinnon, I'm taking for at least 4 shots on goal. He's averaging, as you mentioned, 4.9 shots on goal per game this season. He's had at least 3 and 5 straight and 13 out of 14 and at least 4 shots on goal and 8 out of 14 this season. Anaheim averaging 32 shots against. If you just do those two, you're at +105, which I think is pretty decent value. But then a goal in the first 10 minutes of the third period. Anaheim's only been held below 2.5 goals 5 times this season. They have 25 third period goals this year, 22 total goals in any other period. Yeah. The Avs have scored 19 third period goals this season, 9 in the first, 19 in the second. So we're a bit above the 2-1 mark. And so hopefully we're adding this to my win column. But if not, as I did a week ago, I'll be donating $100 to the Movember Foundation. So, you know, basically finding a way to win regardless with the same game parlay.
All Drew does is win, 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 no matter what. Got money on his mind. He ain't never given up. Is that the words? I don't even know. But yeah, you aren't clean shaven face baby Drew anymore. We're like in our high school to college phase. And then by next week, we'll be in like our manly phase, you know?
It's going to be an interesting Thanksgiving to see it by the end of the year. I don't think I'm going to look like Radko Gudas. I know I just mentioned him. I don't think I'm going to have quite that beard. But I'm glad that it's certainly not like, you know, 2009 Sidney Crosby either. If I could play like him, I would take it. But yeah, it's the beard is actually coming back in, which thankful on that.
Yeah, show what you're made of in men's league tonight. That's all I got to say. Again, the Ducks have quacked their way all the way to the Mile High City to take on the Colorado Avalanche. That game is on tonight at 9 p.m. Eastern time. You can stream it live on ESPN Plus or your local regional networks. Last but not least, let's head north of the border. The Isles have gone from the Big Apple to north of the border in Vancouver to take on the Canucks. We have an offensive juggernaut taking on a defensively solid team. Now, the Isles are second to last in the Metro right now, 5-6-3 record. They've lost the last 5 games. It hasn't been good times in the Big Apple for them. Definitely a different story from them and the Rangers. Now, offensively, they are a bottom 3 team in the league. They're averaging only 2.36 goals per game. That's never really been their game, though. Their game's on the defensive side. But let's talk offensively about Brock Nelson for a second. 8 points through 14 games, 6 goals, only 1 point, though, in the last 5 games. They need him and his surrounding partners to really get involved to find something on the offensive side this year.
Yeah, especially when your leading point getter this year has only 12 points. You've got to have that depth working. And Nelson, 6 goals, 2 assists through his first 14 games. And you mentioned the run he's been on. When you go back to last year, 36 goals, 39 assists. He's on pace for 35 goals this season. He just hasn't had the assist numbers that he had a year ago. So he has been converting at a pace that is similar to last year, similar to the year before when he set a career high in goals, still in that mid-30s range. But he just hasn't been able to get the helpers this year. So getting everybody else for the Islanders, I know you mentioned it. This is not a team that is going to be lighting the lamp at a crazy pace. But 2.3 goals per game is not going to get you into the postseason and deep into the postseason. So you just kind of need a bit more help. Nelson has been good at converting and finishing and creating goals with 6 for the year. But when you're talking about the other leading point getters for the Islanders, Bo Horvat has 4 goals through 13 games. Matthew Barzal, 3 goals through 14 games. Kyle Palmieri, 3 goals through 14 games. And those are the other ones in the top 4 for total points for the Isles this season. That's where they kind of need to step things up if they're going to be contending in what is an incredibly difficult Metro division, especially with the Flyers basically hanging around in the midst of that division there. You can't be only at 2.3 goals a game if you're the Islanders. You've got to get more than that.
And they have created some really good 5-on-5 shots on goal. The finishing just has been almost non-existent at this point. They need to find a way. Maybe that puck luck that you've been talking about to get it going their way. But defensively, the Isles are allowing 3.15 goals per game. They do slow down a game. They muck up the neutral zone. Ilya Sorokin, he's backed in. He's ranked 7th in goals saved above expected per 60 this year. .907 save percentage. This could be good news for the Isles having a guy like that between the pipes. But then you look at who you're going up against, the Canucks. They've been one of the hottest teams in the NHL this year. They're sitting at 2nd in the Pacific behind the reigning Stanley Cup champs and the Vegas Golden Knights. The Canucks 11-3-1 on the season. And offensively, they are the best team in the league at this point. They're averaging 4.4 goals per game. And JT Miller is the team's 2nd leading scorer, 25 points for him in 15 games, 7 goals, and even more impressively, 18 assists. He's really been getting all of his teammates involved on the offensive side.
This is exactly what everybody thought 45 days ago, is that the Canucks would be the best offensive team in the NHL. and right there contending. Also, one of the best in net with Thatcher Demko, who's just been outstanding. JT Miller doing very well, but Vancouver leads the NHL with 39 goals for in 5-on-5 situations. Second best in the NHL with only 20 goals against in 5-on-5. Miller's on a 4-game point streak with 3 goals, 4 assists, and at least 1 point in 10 of his last 12. This Vancouver Canucks team, if they can just keep this pace, if this team that we've seen through their first 15 games this season is who this team is, holy cow, they are just really, it's unreal to see. And Thatcher Demko's young, JT Miller, they're getting the contributions all across the way. You've got Quinn Hughes leading the way defensively with 23 points from the blue line for Vancouver for this year. This Canucks team is just kind of get the popcorn ready on that one because they've just been great in every zone. I don't know if there's anything you could really complain about if you're a Canucks fan, especially because you also live in Vancouver, which is you know, a beautiful place to be. I guess rent is high, but that's the first thing that you could possibly
that's
complain
everywhere.
About if you're a Canucks fan right
Rent's
now.
Rent's high everywhere.
That is everywhere, but Vancouver, yeah.
Yeah, Vancouver for sure. And you also look at them offensively too. They have 10 guys with at least 3 goals. So they're getting that contribution from up and down the lineup. Defensively, if that's not enough on the offensive side being the best in the league, defensively, they're top 4. They're only allowing 2.20 goals per game. They're playing to the structure that Rick Tocchet wanted them to play heading into the season. And you mentioned Thatcher Demko, 935 save percentage, 1.96 goals against average. Definitely exceeding expectations. Who knows if there's going to be some negative regression there, but Canucks fans definitely enjoying it while it lasts. When you look at playing this game, how do you play it? Because at this point, the Isles, they're only plus 138. They're only a slight underdog in this one. And when you look at a team like Vancouver that really has been rolling the way that they are, how do you play it?
I mean, I don't think there's value in the Islanders at plus 138. It's just they're going up against a team that's just so much better. Both of these teams play again tomorrow. So I'm looking at it, I think if you're trying to get creative, if minus 166 on the Vancouver side isn't quite that appealing, a team total under for New York going up against, if Thatcher Demko is confirmed to be in net for tonight, because they do play the Blues tomorrow, so we don't know what they're going to do as far as a goalie split, but that would be what I'd be leaning towards basically the second Demko gets confirmed as the starter for tonight. If he's not, I would just have to look at Vancouver money line, or just kind of go with one of the players, one of the offensive players, or Quinn Hughes to pick up a point or an assist if you just want to get really specific and try and boost that payout. That's kind of the way that I would go, depending on who's in net for the Canucks tonight.
Yeah, at this point, Quinn Hughes has more points on defense than the entire San Jose does goals. San Jose Sharks team has goals this season, which is pretty crazy to think. But again, this game's going to be a fun one. The Isles trying to snap a 5-game losing skid while the Canucks try to keep it rolling this season. That's the second game of a double dip on TNT tonight at 10 p.m. Eastern time. You can also stream it live on Max. Then we'll take it to the top. We have the Philadelphia Flyers taking on the Carolina Hurricanes. That game is on tonight, 7:30 p.m. on TNT. You can stream it live on Max. The Kraken, north of the border, taking on the Edmonton Oilers, who are trying to figure it out right now, 8:30 p.m. on ESPN Plus, Sportsnet, and Root Sports. And last but not least, the Mile High City, the Ducks, wah, 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 quacking all the way there. That game's on tonight at 9 p.m. Eastern time on ESPN Plus and your local regional networks. Happy Wine Wednesday, everyone. Enjoy the 4-game slate tonight. Drew and I will see you tomorrow. Until then, peace out. And Drew, go kick butt tonight at Beer League. You got it.
Woo!